Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Revenge by Hannah Jayne. Narrated by Rudy Sanda and Monique Makena. 1. Tony. Hope reached out to me, the tips of her fingers brushing over my forearms, sending a barrage of goosebumps up my body. She was leaning into me, close enough that I could see the light bounce off her glossy, pushed-out lower lip, could smell the faint scent of strawberry on her hair. Hope was the most beautiful girl in the world, and she was mine. Close enough to touch, to hold, to kiss. So close that I...
"Our love is a flower," she cooed.
The words pricked at the backs of my ears. Something wasn't right. Hope. The room wasn't as dark as I'd thought it was. The light shifted slowly, and I could make out shadows, rapt, staring. We weren't alone.
"That blooms,"
Hope went on. "No." I could feel the burn up the back of my neck. Could feel the sweat start to bead at my hairline.
"Hope, please don't."
My voice sounded weird and high and pathetic. Hope's eyes flashed with something like an apology and then hardened into slits of silver. The edges of her lips turned up into the smirk I had once found so sexy but now cut at me and turned my stomach.
"That brightens each and every room."
Her words dissolved into laughter that came from every corner, reverberating, thundering through my skull. The lights were on. I was in the school hallway, and everyone was pointing, laughing. Except for Hope. She was in the middle of them all, her serpentine tongue dashing across those stupid, glossy lips as she read my poem out loud. One eye quirked in a silent, biting threat.
"Everyone's on my side, Tony."
She didn't even move her lips.
"I brought you up from loser status just to crush you back down again."
I woke up tangled in the sheets, my chest damp, my heart clanging like a fire bell. "Hope." I kicked my legs over the side of the bed and dropped my head into my hands.
"Jesus."
It had been just over 12 hours since I broke up with Hope Jensen. I dumped the most popular girl in school. I hadn't meant to, hadn't planned it. I really did love Hope. She was funny and smart and gorgeous, but she also had a mean streak that was hard to stomach. She was a pseudo-celeb and a trust fund baby. So for the first few months when she made comments, I could brush them off. She didn't realize she was being shallow when she made the occasional snide comment about someone's clothes or hair or car. She didn't understand that not everyone lived the way that she did, that not everything was going to go her way. We were different, and pretty soon the novelty of dating me, a poor kid so far out of her league, was going to wear off. I thought I was doing her a favor. I took her to the beach. Did it in private. Even made it look like it was all my fault. I thought we were cool. Hope agreed. We hugged. She said we would still be friends. The next day, she gave me a big, dazzling Hope Jensen smile and told everyone I had a raging case of herpes. A day after that, Hope ripped my heart out in front of the whole school, then did a little tap dance on it by reading the letters I had written her out loud. I wanted to forget about it, to forget about her. But after dating her for 7 months, she was everywhere. Her cheerleading picture stuck to the side of my computer monitor. The homecoming court picture where one of her gorgeous tanned legs jutted out of the slit of her dress. The selfies she called ussies, our faces smashed together and taking up the entire frame. I snatched one of those down and ripped it apart, tearing Hope in half right between the eyes. My phone was glowing on the bedside table, and I thumbed it, rolling down a line of tweets calling me everything from a loser to a wannabe to a pathetic loser wannabe. Fucking Hope. When I opened my laptop, she was there too. A collage of pictures of her grinning, strutting, posing, and making kissy faces while the students in the background adored her on my screensaver, just like I had. But that was over now. If she was going to mess up my life, I was going to mess up hers. My fingers raced over the keyboard. I went to every website I could think of. I signed Hope up for everything from breast pads to dating websites. I sent her free samples by the truckload. Hemorrhoid creams, Depends, strawberry-flavored lube, pet food samples, hookup sites, neo-Nazi support groups, Desert Storm Survivor chat rooms, Hope Jensen, DOB, 519-2000, Dial-A-Bride, Hot Singles in Your Area, Hope Jensen, Blonde Hair, Blue Eyes, Tinder, Love Space, Bang Book, Hope Jensen, 5'7", 108 pounds, open to anything. The sun was starting to break through the blackness outside, and I yawned, glancing back at my glowing laptop screen. Hope's information was still up on my screen. Phone number, email address, home address. Right before I logged off, a dialog box popped up with a single question. Share location? My eyes flitted over the pictures of Hope surrounding my screen. The smile that now seemed smug. The eyes that suddenly seemed so hard and cold. I heard her voice in my head. That saccharine sweet tone slipping over the words I had given to her, that I had given to her in confidence, in private. I hovered over the share location question and clicked yes. 2. I grinned when I drove past Hope's house the next morning. There was a pizza guy on the front stoop. Gotta love those 24-hour delivery guys. Holding a half dozen pies and jamming his finger against the bell. I could imagine Hope stomping through the mammoth front hall, her hair half done, livid that someone would dare interrupt her beauty routine. In chemistry, Hope made a big show of not sitting near me, telling Mr. Howard that she'd prefer a new lab partner while cutting her eyes to me, then rolling them dramatically. Mr. Howard shrugged. You can sit wherever you like as long as you turn your phone off. Hope glared at her phone. I can't help it. I'm getting like 50 calls every minute. I don't know how all these idiots suddenly got my phone number. I had a hard time hiding my satisfied smile. Angela, the girl who sat behind me and who would probably end up being my new lab partner, kicked the back of my chair. When I turned around, she jutted her chin toward Hope and then raised her eyebrows. Angela and I weren't really friends, just two kids who went to the same school. She was new last year and hadn't really joined any group that I knew of, but we were on pretty good terms. I leaned against her desk and lowered my voice to a whisper.
It's possible I may have accidentally leaked a teensy...
I held my thumb and forefinger a millimeter apart.
Bit of Hope's personal information. Like her phone number.
Angela's lips turned up into an appreciative half smile.
And her address.
No one else was talking to me, unless you counted the guys who were my friends yesterday coughing pussy and loser into their hands every time I passed. So it felt good to have someone make direct eye contact.
I'm surprised you even dated her, she whispered to me.
I shrugged, smiling to hide the sting. No one thought Hope should be with me. She was a knockout with a mean streak, a and I was just me. But for all her issues, she was awesome, too. She had a tough exterior. She had to, she told me, because everyone always wanted something from her. But with me, she was soft. Or at least that's what I'd thought. When the bell rang, Hope tossed me a last slicing glare before her two best friends flanked her and walked her out of the classroom, holding on to her arms like she would crumble from the stress of 42 pizzas at any minute. Angela came up alongside me, crossing her arms in front of her chest. "That girl's a real piece of work." I nodded, but kept my eyes on Hope. She let out a whoosh of air as her phone rang, then held it to her ear. Angela was saying something, but I was straining to hear Hope over the din. Then, loud, from Hope,
"No, I am not up for whatever. That's disgusting. How did you get this number?"
She let out one of her signature groans and stomped her foot. Payback's a bitch. The school day flew by, and Hope's name was on everyone's lips. They weren't talking about me, about our breakup. It was all Hope. "Did you hear that someone delivered 40 pizzas to her house? Someone left a gross note on her car. Her phone has been blowing up." I hung back, listening, laughing. There was a part of me that felt sorry for her, but that part was tiny. Hope had ruined me for no reason. She had turned the school against me, and I didn't even know why. She was my girlfriend. She had told me she loved me. Let me put my hand under that huge slit in her homecoming dress. I had loved her. I thought we could end on good terms. But clearly, Hope didn't think that way. She deserved everything that was coming to her. 3. My phone was ringing. I rolled over and knocked half the stuff off my nightstand before finding it. "Hello?"
"Tony?"
I sat up, rubbing my eyes and yawning. "Hope? What time is it?"
"It's 9:30 at night, you jackass. Were you asleep already?"
I glanced at the bedside clock and then at myself, lying on top of my sheets and fully clothed. "No." Hope sucked in a long breath and then dropped her voice.
"Look, Tony, I know it was you. I know you put my name and address and phone number all over the internet."
I wanted to feel proud of myself, but I was still confused and sleep-addled, somehow hoping that Hope was calling to apologize for spreading the rumor, for reading my poems out loud.
"You have to take it off."
"What?"
"My name, my picture, my info. You have to take it off the internet, Tony, right now."
The shrill tone of her voice cut through my fog and right down to my anger. Why would I do that?
"It's not fair."
"Like you humiliating me in front of the entire school?"
"You dumped me, remember?"
Her voice was a tight snarl. I was too angry to reconsider, to be taken aback. "And reading my letters out loud to your fan base? What the hell, Hope? What did I do to you? I thought we were good." I could feel the lump forming in my throat, and I tried to get angry again but couldn't. "You told me you loved me." Hope paused for a beat. Her voice was soft.
"Please, Tony."
"Please what?"
"Take my information off the internet."
I was rubbing my temples, shaking my head. "You deserve whatever you get, Hope."
"Please."
Her voice was shrill, but this time with a soft, quavering edge.
"People have been calling me."
That made me smile. "And dropping shit off on your porch. I don't care.
Just like you apparently didn't care about my feelings before you... I think someone followed me home. There was a hint of desperation in her voice. But Hope could turn her emotions at the snap of a finger. She was an expert at getting what she wanted. Going from cheerful and bubbly one moment to a sobbing, heart-wrenching mess the next. She was good. I'm sure it's probably one of your many admirers. Good night. No, please, please take everything down. I'm sorry, okay? I'm sorry, and I think someone has been following me, and I'm really scared. What if some psycho got my address off the internet and is stalking me? I rolled my eyes. Goodbye, Hope. Tony! It sounded like Hope had dropped the phone, probably kicking it for dramatic effect. Then I heard it. A scuffle. The low grumble of a male voice. A sharp no from Hope. Arguing. A faint scream. The eek of wheels peeling out. And then nothing. 4. My pulse ratcheted up, and I pressed the phone to my ear, trying to hear more. I screamed Hope's name, but there was no response. No giggle followed by some insult so typically Hope, lame ass or dumb freak or jackwad. There was just silence. Hope? Pause. Hope, come on. Silence. I jumped out of bed and grabbed my keys and was halfway out the door before I figured it out. Typical Hope. Nothing was ever her fault. Things always went her way. Hope always got what she wanted. She was a pseudo-celeb not just at school, but in town, too. Her parents co-hosted a morning news show, and Hope was their golden child. Smart, pretty, sunshine out her ass perfect. I had seen her work the system. She never paid for coffee or breakfast or anything at Effie's because the television was always tuned to Channel 7. And every morning, Bruce and Becky Jensen smiled out at Effie's clientele and included the syrup-stained masses in their affable family banter. Thus, the prodigal daughter should never want for a scone or a lumberjack scramble. She got out of speeding tickets and parking tickets, and once nicked a car but got off with a warning because the other driver was such a big fan. Hope pretended that she hated dealing with the great unwashed. That's what she called everyone who fawned over her and her parents. But she reveled in it. Even had a shelf in her room stuffed with plush animals and ugly trinkets that her parents' fans had given her. She also had a closet shelf loaded with booze and pills, uppers and downers, courtesy of the other rich kids. She had probably staged the whole scream and squeal. I imagined her screaming into the phone, then holding the thing up to her laptop as a car peeled out on Furious 7. She was probably laughing while my heart thudded against my chest as I looked for my keys, ready to save the day. I sat back, stretched out on my bed again, and stared at my phone. Hope would call back any minute, furious that I hadn't dialed her 1,000 times. She was probably counting the minutes now, waiting. Any minute now. She thought she knew me so well. I glanced at the clock, watching the red glowing numbers on my alarm tick off minute after minute. Damn it, Hope! 5. Going out, honey? My parents were snuggled on the couch, watching some old movie on TV. I flipped my keys, grateful that my parents were pretty hands-off, that between working since I was 15 and basically striking out with girls until Hope came along, I had earned their respect, their stamp of, "He's too boring to worry about curfews." Just going to run a quick errand. My dad glanced at his watch. It's after 9:30. I just need to grab something for a project. 30 minutes tops. I'll be right back. I was out the door before they could say anything else. I dialed Hope 3 times in the 12 minutes it took me to drive to her place. I wasn't surprised when she didn't answer, just annoyed. Part of me knew I was playing right into her hands and hated myself for it. The other part was a tight ball of anxiety. What if something actually happened to her? I heard the scream in my mind again, the squeal of tires. That sounded real, didn't it? She's messing with you, I told myself, gritting my teeth and biting down hard until my jaws ached. She's just going to laugh when you get there. Hope's house, a massive estate set back from the private drive, was lit with outdoor lights, but the house itself was dark. I parked anyway and strode to the door, knocking.
Hope, I yelled. It's me. Open up.
Nothing. I glanced at my phone again, texted her, told her I was waiting outside. No response. I dialed her again, groaning, then cocked my head, listening to the stereo ringing going on. One on my phone, one on hers. Faint, but I'd recognize the ring anywhere. Hope had specialized rings for everyone. I pulled my phone from my ear.
Hope?
My phone kept ringing. So did hers. I followed the sound down her porch, around the winding patch of golf course short grass.
Hope?
The phone stopped ringing and went to her voicemail. I hung up, speed dialed her again, and made a beeline down the walk, down the drive, then hunched into the gutter where the tune was slightly less muffled. I poked at the mess of leaves caught in the gutter grate, my heart doing a double thump when a faded light flashed behind the debris. I pushed the leaves aside, and my own face was staring up at me as the phone vibrated and rang. The words, "Call from Tony G," were warped by the dirt, by the broken glass on the face of the phone, but it was definitely Hope's phone. And it was in the gutter. My heart started to pound. Had it really? I took a deep breath. Hope would pull out all the stops to make it look like she'd been kidnapped. But her phone. Hope's phone was her lifeline. She was never without it. I couldn't imagine her dumping it, even for a prank of this magnitude. I picked her phone out of the gutter, shook off some leaves, smoothed off the dirt, and checked her call log. Her call to me, my return calls to her, 3 calls from someone with the initials RR, 2 calls back. RR? Renee Wright. Riri. Hope's best friend. RR. Cracked screen. Cement scratched edges. The phone had definitely been dropped. Or tossed, I reminded myself. I was still hunched over the gutter when the headlights cut through the night, flooded me, and burned my eyes. I glanced up, squinted.
Everything okay here, son?
It was the security guard who patrolled Hope's neighborhood. The guy was a rent-a-cop on a power trip, who had caught me and Hope in her car or mine more times than I cared to count. We were both pretty sure he was a semi-closeted perv who was into Hope and lived every day hoping he would catch her with her shirt off, but it was never going to happen. Hope liked the attention and trilled and drawled when he flooded our car with light, playing up her smeared lipstick and ruffled hair and acting all hot and bothered. She liked to see his eyes go round and glassy, liked to see the flush in his cheeks. But the guy gave me the creeps. He peered at me from his car now, eyes narrowed. As usual, all I could see were those beady eyes from under his Atlas security hat,
his lips pressed together as he scrutinized me. I pocketed Hope's phone and stood up, brushing my hands on my pants. Yeah, just drop my phone. The rent-a-cop and I stared at each other for a beat. He seemed to be daring me to make the first move. Finally, you visiting the Jensens tonight? I glanced over my shoulder as if checking that the house was still there. No. No one's home. Just heading out, actually. The cop got out of his car, slamming the door behind him and walking slowly toward me. He had his hands on his hips, television cop style. But instead of a gun belt, all he had was an enormous flashlight that hung halfway to his knee. So, I thumbed over my shoulder toward where I was parked. I guess I'm just gonna go. I turned on my heel. He kept his eye on me until I got into my car, then kept staring until I turned over the engine and backed into the street. I could see his headlights still fixed on Hope's driveway as I slowly drove away. I got to school just before the first bell and strolled the halls, telling myself I wasn't looking for Hope. I didn't want to, but part of me was genuinely curious. The other part was sure she was keeping to the dark corners so she could spring out at lunchtime and call me a dick for almost getting her kidnapped. Just like the rest of her life, it was probably some publicity stunt. Another show for the whole school to laugh at me and fawn over her. For a girl who hated her parents with a fiery vengeance, she was just like them. I filed into ethics with everyone else. Renee and Ashley, two of Hope's current BFFs, stared at their phones until the second the bell rang, then looked around, their overly made-up eyes falling on Hope's empty seat. "Where's Hope?" Renee mouthed to me. I rolled my eyes and shrugged, not wanting to play a role in another of their stupid games. "Okay, okay, everyone, settle down." Mrs. Patton was always late to class, always carrying an armful of notebooks and a coffee mug she never seemed to drink out of. Renee's arm shot up. "Yes, Ms. Wright?" "Mrs. Patton, Hope isn't here today. Is it okay if I call her and check in?" Renee pointed to her phone as if to prove that her intentions were honorable. Mrs. Patton blew out a sigh and shook her head. "No, Renee. If you want to call someone, please do it between classes." "But Mrs. Patton, Hope didn't tell me she wasn't going to be here today. She tells me everything. I'm worried." Mrs. Patton pinched the bridge of her nose like Renee was giving her a headache, which I'm sure she was. "She's probably just sick. Call her on your break." I shifted in my seat, glad Mrs. Patton was strict. Hope's phone was rolling around in my glove box. Renee's hand shot up again. "But Mrs.—" "Not now," Mrs. Patton snapped. Class passed uneventfully, and when it ended, Renee was on her phone before the bell stopped ringing. I could see her face fall a little more with each ring, and my heartbeat started to speed up. "She's just trying to screw with you, Tony," I told myself. "Hope is fine. Probably just hanging out at her house, eating bonbons and watching herself on old episodes of her parents' show, Wake Up the Bay." Hope's parents were never around, and she was a fan of taking the more than occasional mental health day. The school didn't even bother to call her house, since her parents were at the studio all day, and when you're a celebrity, even the local one, the rules were different for you and your offspring. The rest of my morning classes were uneventful as I moved through the halls and into the cafeteria, taking stock of the huge crowd in there. I was starving, but as I looked at the packed tables, I was losing my appetite rapidly. Without Hope and our, or her, gang,
I had no one to eat lunch with. I had friends before Hope, but she never liked them, and I never bothered to stand up for them when Hope made fun of them, so they were long gone now. I slid my tray along the lunch line, selecting the least gray-looking hamburger and a paper cup of limp French fries.
Oh, it's our poet literate.
I had drunk beers with Rustin Rice in his backyard over Labor Day before Hope ripped my heart out. He was an idiot, but an all right guy. Or he was before he thunked into me, slamming the edge of his tray hard into my left kidney, his soda sloshing from the cup and onto my t-shirt. He laughed at his own stupid, poorly worded joke. Hey, Rice, I said, my words barely audible through my gritted teeth.
Write any good poems lately?
The kids in the lunch line behind Rice, a couple of girls we ate lunch with, a few underclassmen, and a kid I didn't recognize, laughed with him, and I could feel the heat sear my cheeks. I hope it looked like anger rather than niggling embarrassment that wouldn't go away. I threw my money down to the lunch lady and popped my earbuds into my ears, trying to drown out the peals of laughter. I could still hear them. I dumped my food in the nearest trash can, my stomach turning over on itself, and made a beeline to the front hallway. Two girls I recognized, Renee from class and her friend Everly, were standing shoulder to shoulder, leaning into each other and whispering furiously. They stopped when they saw me, each eyeing me without trying to hide it. I gave them a slight nod of my head. Hey. Renee looked disgusted.
Hey? Is that all you have to say for yourself?
Hey, Renee? She grunted. Everly gave a little snort.
You know that Hope's not here today, right?
Renee said, hands on hips, lips pressed in an accusatory line. I shrugged. Yeah, I noticed. She sick or something? Now Renee snorted and Everly grunted.
Like you don't know. You know she was being stalked, right?
She narrowed her eyes.
Of course you know. You were responsible.
I wasn't stalking Hope. She was my girlfriend.
Yeah, Everly said matter-of-factly. And then she dumped you.
I nodded, happy to let them believe whatever Hope had told them. Yeah, it happens. No big deal.
So, she dumps you. Then, like a day later, she's getting prank phone calls. Pizza sent to her house at all hours. Random disgusting stuff sent to her. Adult diapers and crap like that.
Renee was on a roll. I tried to hide my head as I grinned and loosely congratulated myself. Wrong move, as it apparently incensed Renee.
Oh, you think that's funny? How did all these people get her phone number, Tony? Or her address?
I felt my face flush, but tried to ignore it. Tried to stay calm. I don't know. One of those star maps, I grinned. Renee gaped. Celebrities get hacked all the time. And Hope pretty much fancies herself a celebrity, right? Comes with the territory. She should have been more careful, I guess. Renee looked like she was about to explode. But Everly caught my eye and gave me a small smile before looking away. She thought it was funny, too. Besides, this isn't the first time Hope hasn't shown up at school. She's probably home lying on the couch. I turned, ready to head down the hall.
Except that she's not, Renee said, her voice stark.
Her mother called me and asked if I'd seen Hope. Obviously, she's not home on the couch if her own mother doesn't know where she is. I paused at this, a tiny prickle of guilt itching the back of my neck. Was she home at all last night? I took a deep breath. Even if she wasn't, it didn't mean anything. I thought of the crushed gutter phone, the one that was now stashed in my glove box.
This was Hope, the girl who left nothing to chance. She had a million hiding places and 3 credit cards.
While most kids drank a few beers in the supermarket parking lot to get away, Hope rented a hotel room or went to the Bahamas or holed up in a dressing room at Nordstrom. She wasn't exactly the down-and-out type. "I'm sure Hope is just fine," I muttered before leaving. But unease lit in my gut, and I couldn't seem to shake it. 6. By the end of the school day, Hope was all anyone was talking about. I hadn't spoken to anyone other than during my unfortunate run-ins with Renee and Everly, but everyone seemed to know something. There was a phone call, or I was the last to see or talk to her, or that she was really scared of something or someone who had contacted her. The scandal had all the markings of a Hope scheme. Her friends seemed to be the most in the know, but also were spitting out little morsels of information when it suited them. Every time I passed Renee or Ashley on my way to class or in the hall, they shredded me with their razor blade stares, or immediately got on their rhinestone-studded phones and started whispering frantically. It wouldn't be the first time Hope had exacted revenge. When she lost out for editor of the school newspaper, she had her parents donate enough money to start the school news channel, with herself as primary anchor. Her first story was an expose on the journalism teacher, highlighting his DUI arrest. When she lost out for homecoming queen, Hope threw a wild, over-the-top party at the same time as the dance, so the homecoming queen was crowned with an empty court and exactly 6 people on the dance floor. Hope could be sweet, smart, and funny, as long as you didn't cross her. And boy, did she love a good revenge. When the Florence High newscast flashed across the flat panels in 6th period, the headline news was, "Where is Hope?" I had rolled my eyes. She had been gone less than a day. Some of the students in class were rapt, sitting up and watching the newscast. Other kids had barely looked up from their laptop or phone or book, and one kid, Lance Hutchings, a fringe burner no one paid attention to, actually snorted and rolled his eyes. "She probably stayed home with a yeast infection or something," he muttered, crossing his arms in front of his chest and sliding low in his desk. "Why is a sick chick news?" Renee, we were lucky to be in nearly every class together, shot him one of the looks I thought she only reserved for me and growled.
"She's been missing almost 24 hours. She didn't come home last night, you miscreant. She's not homesick. She's missing."
Renee positively hissed the word, and I strangled a laugh in my throat.
"Yep. Orchestrated. Straight out of a Hope's Leave 'em Wanting More playbook."
Lance rolled his eyes again. "If it were anyone else in this class, no one would give a crap. It sure wouldn't make the news." He raised a dismissive hand, letting everyone know how he felt about the caliber of Florence High School's reporting. Renee narrowed her eyes.
"And where were you last night, Lance?"
He waggled his eyebrows.
"Maybe you should ask your friend Hope."
The newscast then flashed to a special message, and even I straightened in my seat. The Jensens. Looking distraught and uncomfortable, perched on the very edges of their fancily upholstered morning show chairs. The camera tightened its angle on the couple.
"As some of you know, our daughter Hope, a junior at your high school, didn't come home last night," Bruce started.
Becky nodded next to him, wide-eyed and serious. She cleared her throat and licked her lips.
"Hope has always checked in with us,
has always been open and honest with us. At this point, she's not answering her cell phone and has not been active on social media since 8 p.m. last night. If you have any information that might be pertinent, even if it doesn't seem like anything important, please, please contact us or the police.
I dazed out as a number flashed on the screen.
A car that you didn't recognize at school, or someone on campus, perhaps. Maybe you had a conversation with Hope that seemed...
Becky shrugged her tiny shoulders.
Different, somehow?
I didn't have to turn around to know that everyone was staring at me.
Didn't Hope and Tony have a...
A kid who sat behind me made air quotes. Different kind of conversation the other day? There was a round of low laughter, cut by Renee's sneer.
This is serious! Tony and Hope broke up,
Everly said carefully, and I wasn't sure if she was on my side or not.
It happens.
Yeah, and 2 days later, Hope goes missing. Anger and guilt sat like flat stones in the pit of my stomach. What exactly are you trying to say, Renee? Renee crossed her arms in front of her chest and popped her lip out in that mean girl way that I'm pretty sure Hope had coined. She didn't say anything. She didn't have to. Accusation wafted from her. The whole class was silent for an agonizing minute that seemed to stretch on. I jumped when Lance clapped a hand on my back. Looks like you're about to be famous, dude. By the time we were dismissed from class, the student body had grown into one pulsing mass, talking, whispering, pointing, staring at me. I kept my head down, trying to make a straight line for the student lot in my car, but there were people everywhere.
That's Tony Gardner, I heard a shrill voice yelling. He's Hope's ex-boyfriend.
When I looked up, I saw that it was Renee talking to a police officer. My temperature ratcheted up, but the officer just looked at me and nodded, jotting something down in his notebook. I got in my car just as I saw the Channel 7 news van pull into the school's horseshoe-shaped parking lot. Looks like you're about to be famous, dude. 7. The gossip and stares were worse the second day. People were convinced Hope wasn't just missing, but that she'd actually been kidnapped. If you listened to the rumors, the gossip, she had been snatched and sold into white slavery, or ended up as serial killer fodder, or had been taken by Colombians for a hefty ransom. She had skipped town due to drugs, run off with an internet boyfriend or a Tunisian prince. Someone's cousin had spotted her in Hawaii or the Barbados. She had been working on her GED and was recruited by Quantico.
We just want her back safely, Renee wailed in biology class.
No one talked to me, but everyone was talking about me.
The boyfriend did it, someone muttered as I stood at my locker.
I thought the butler always did it. Someone else guffawed.
Who else was mad at Hope?
Everyone, I wanted to scream. Hope burned everyone. That was how she operated. She was the celebrity darling, the princess of Florence High.
She had followers and admirers and flatterers, and when she loved you fiercely with all her heart and soul and bank accounts and privilege. But when she was through with you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.